Let's look at basics of communications. What are the elements of an analog radio communication system? If you look at the block diagram, it clearly explains the sequence. Look at the various blocks. There is an input transducer, followed by a modulator, followed by a transmitter and an antenna. The signal propagates through the channel. Since it's a radio communication, the channel is nothing but air. At the receiver, the receiving antenna receives a signal, followed by a receiver block, which is further followed by a demodulator and a transducer, and the transducer output is actually the signal. Let's have some examples of analog messages. Analog messages can be voice, music, video, temperature, pressure, etc. Now, what's a transducer? Transducer actually converts one form of energy into a different form of energy. For example, microphone converts acoustic speech into electrical signal. A loudspeaker converts electrical signal back to acoustic signal. Hey, tell me some modulation types that you know. We are all familiar with analog modulation, which consists of amplitude modulation, frequency modulation and phase modulation. In the digital modulation, some of the popular types are PCM and delta modulation. Now tell me, why modulation is required? Modulation is a signal processing which helps, in fact, to cleverly hide the signal in a carrier so that the signal is protected against noise during propagation or transmission. Modulation is also a process which performs upward frequency translation of the signal. What do we mean by this? It shifts the lower frequency signal to a higher frequency spectrum so that the wavelength decreases. Oh my god, what is wavelength? Let's recall that lambda is equal to C by F, where C is velocity of light, F is frequency of the signal, and lambda is the wavelength. If the wavelength decreases, it can be propagated through shorter antennas. We know antennas radiate efficiently between lambda by 4 and lambda by 2 wavelength, that is quarter wavelength to half wavelength. If the frequency of the signal to be transmitted, let's say, is 10 kilohertz, then by all these calculations, the antenna length at lambda by 4 that is required to transmit this signal will be 30,000 meters, and this is absolutely impractical. On the other hand, if we employ a modulation process and that upconverts the frequency of the signal to 10 megahertz, let's say, then the required antenna length becomes 30 meters, which is of course manageable. So these are some of the reasons why modulation is deployed in any communication system. Okay, let's now move on to the transmitter. What is its role? Transmitter invariably is a power amplifier to boost the power of the signal so that it can be carried over longer distances. But this can also include some modulation such as ASK, FSK, PSK, QPSK, QAM, GMSK, etc. The reader can figure out what is ASK, FSK, PSK, etc. and I am not going to tell them. Let's have some examples of analog communication systems. The examples are AM, FM and TV radio transmissions, which are very popular. What are the elements of a digital radio communication system? Let's look at this block diagram. The various blocks that are there are source encoder, channel encoder, modulator and transmitter. Through the antenna, it goes over the channel. At the receiver, antenna followed by receiver, demodulator, transducer and output transducer. These are the blocks that are there in the digital radio communication system. So, let's have some examples of each of these blocks. Discrete message can be computer data. Source encoder can be quantizers like PCM quantizer or delta modulation quantizer, DPCM, ADPCM, etc., etc. The channel encoders may deal with error correction, where error correction bits are added to protect the signal against the noise in the channel. Parity coders, Hamming coders, convolutional coders, CRC, etc. are also part of channel encoding. Transmitter invariably is a power amplifier, and that also can include at times modulation such as QPSK, QAM, GMSK, etc. What are the digital communication systems that you know? LAN, Internet, SONET, E1 MUX, T1 MUX, etc. What is SONET, E1, T1? Well, not from me. You please explore all this. In this, we will discuss amplitude modulation in greater detail. So, let's look at some of the analog modulations. Can you define amplitude modulation? Can you define frequency modulation? Can you define phase modulation? In a concise way, AM or FM or PM, let's move on to frequency modulation. Look at the animation, which clearly explains the process of frequency modulation. As a quick recap, let's review some of the highlights of frequency modulation also. First one is bandwidth versus signal to noise ratio trade-off. One significant feature of FM is its excellent quality. All of us are familiar with the FM music transmission and we know how good it is. FM has this property wherein the quality of transmission improves if we are willing to allocate more bandwidth. For example, AM music has a bandwidth of 5 kHz and the quality is average. But FM music has a bandwidth nearly 180 kHz and has excellent quality. In general, in telecommunications, the golden rule is, if you want excellent quality, you pay for it in terms of bandwidth. It's another matter that even this hypothesis is being challenged recently with the advent of bandwidth compression techniques. Let us look at some of the important terms that are employed in frequency modulation. The first one is modulation index MF. This is the ratio of frequency deviation and modulating frequency. There is a problem worked out there which will bring the concept of modulation index rather clearly. The next one is there are a number of sidebands that appear in frequency modulation, unlike AM where there are only two sidebands. As the modulation index increases, the number of significant sidebands also increase. Please look at the table provided, which gives the basic idea of significant sidebands. Now let's look at Carson's rule, which defines bandwidth. Bandwidth as per Carson's rule is twice delta F plus FM, where delta F is the frequency deviation and FM is the modulating frequency. There's a problem worked out there. You can figure it out yourself. What is narrow band FM? Well, the definition of narrow band FM is its frequency deviation should be less than 0.6. That means it is a modulation scheme where the deviation of the carrier is restricted to very low values. Let's now compare FM and AM. FM has got lots of advantages over AM. FM receivers have limiters which can reduce noise. That means signal to noise ratio in FM is superior to AM. By increasing frequency deviation, further reduction in noise is possible in FM. This is what we saw just now. If we are willing to spend on bandwidth, the signal to noise ratio can really improve. SNR versus bandwidth trade-off. Thirdly, FM operates at VHF and UHF frequencies, whereas AM operates at medium frequencies and high frequencies, and this MF and HF are particularly noise prone. In FM, carrier power does useful work, whereas in AM, the carrier power is just wasted. FM, of course, has disadvantages as well. The first disadvantage is it requires a significantly higher bandwidth than AM. FM transmitters and receivers are more complex than AM. We are not going to discuss phase modulation. It's left to the reader to look into that. The reader is advised to read, in particular, pre-emphasis and the inverse frequency relationship between FM and PM.